Imagine for a moment a street lined with picturesque green ash trees towering above you. Shade from the sun, protection from the rain, the perfect spot for your dream hammock. The benefits are endless, but all of those benefits are being wiped out, leaving neighborhoods bare and empty by something no bigger than a half inch in length. It's the emerald ash borer. This beetle is responsible for destroying more than 50 million ash trees in the United States since it was first discovered here in 2002. And it's here in Monroe County. If you ignore the headlines in the past about the emerald ash borer, I've invited three guests to join me and explain why you can't ignore the warnings anymore. In the studio is Walt Nelson, horticulture program leader from Monroe County's Cornell University Cooperative Extension, Noreen Reardon, member of the Monroe County Emerald Ash Borer Task Force and co-owner of Summit Tree and Landscape, and Mark Quinn, superintendent of horticulture from Monroe County Parks, also a member of Monroe County's Emerald Ash Borer Task Force, as is Walt Nelson. Welcome to all of you, and thank you for joining me.
Thank you.
So just to begin, how serious is the emerald ash borer? Because I can guarantee we've got viewers tuning in on television or watching online, and they're thinking, why are they talking about this? So how much of a threat is this little beetle that people may not realize? And Walt, I'll give that to you.
Well, in Monroe County, we're looking at somewhere between 25% and 35% of our tree stock is ash trees. And the emerald ash borer is efficient enough to take out 100% of the ash trees.
So, and I've read, and correct me if I'm wrong, the emerald ash borer originated in East Asia, and it was first discovered in the U.S. in Michigan. How did it get here?
Well, it probably came on packing material, either pallets or ship packing, and it probably arrived in the 1990s. They found it in 2002, but it had probably been on this continent for a while prior to that. It took a while for them to realize there was a problem out there. And most likely, again, we have a lot of trade with Asia, so it probably came in on packing, wood packing material.
Well, I understand it was 2009 when the EAB, as it's called, also was first appeared in New York. And since then, several task forces have been established throughout the state, including the volunteer-run Monroe County EAB Task Force. So what's happening locally to address this issue in the city of Rochester and also Monroe County?
Well, the city of Rochester has taken a proactive stance now 2 years ago when they started to inject trees that they felt were appropriate for the community to retain. And so they have protected just shy of 5,000 ash trees in the city of Rochester. And at the same time, identifying trees that really weren't in great shape, and they're removing those.
And then when we look at the municipalities, we look throughout the city of Rochester, you know, are people stepping up, or are there gaps in terms of dealing with this?
I think the response is quite varied. Some of the towns have taken very aggressive stances on how to deal with trees, and others are kind of playing with the wait and see type of thing. So it depends on how you value your tree. I think certain towns have decided that the treatment would be too expensive and they were going to do takedowns, and other towns have aggressively treated their trees. So there's a wide variety of responses locally by government as well as by individuals.
I know if you were to do a Google alert on the emerald ash borer, you would get emails daily. And I'm trying to figure out, and from research, Walt, we talked about this prior to this interview, why does it seem that we're not hearing about residents having these conversations amongst themselves and being proactive? Is there a lack of public awareness? Has the message not been shared enough? Or are people just generally ignoring it?
I think we have we've made an effort. The task force and others have made an effort, industry has made an effort, arborists have made an effort to create awareness. But, you know, it's going to cost some money somewhere along the line. And if you've got a food on the table or a house to repair or whatever, you know, you're going to put that off. Unfortunately, we can't put the emerald ash borer off.
Noreen, were you going to add a point to that?
I think there's people have an awful lot going on, and maybe people don't realize the value of trees for their property or for their enjoyment or for, you know, health of the community. And I do think that we have tried a lot to get the message out. A lot of people want to take the wait and see attitude, which in this case is a big mistake.
So the big question, how do we stop the emerald ash borer from spreading. Is there a way to get ahead of this?
Well, I'll take that. There's several things that we try to do, and one of the things we're aggressively pursuing is try to stop the movement of the emerald ash borer, which means don't move ash products, ash firewood. There's actually laws within the state of New York that you can't move firewood more than 50 miles. The state has quarantines, and we're in a quarantine zone, so you can't move wood material, ash material, outside the quarantine zone, including a nursery stock. So the object is to keep it from spreading as fast as it could if we move too much wood material. Individual ash trees can be treated, ash trees can be removed, but the likelihood is in the long run it will spread continually unless some biological control is found over time. So.
Well, Noreen, we followed you one day, and you were treating several ash trees on someone's property, and we've got that video. I want viewers to check this out because it has you really explaining the process in terms of treatment, as Mark just mentioned. So we'll take a look at this.
The way it works is the larvae are underneath the bark, and they're feeding on the system that takes the nutrients and water up and down the trunk. So the larvae are cutting off the circulation of the tree. So what these plugs do is they isolate the chemical into that same area where the larvae are feeding. So it will kill off the larvae that are under the bark. And the tree itself actually carries the insecticide up into the canopy by transpiration. And the leaves are kind of like the lungs of the tree, and they pull the fluid up. So you have to have the leaves completely fully formed before you can do the treatments, because it's the leaves and the transpiration that are going to take the chemical up into the tree itself.
So that was a nice look from the outside in terms of treatment of ash trees. But Walt, you've got something here to show us what's actually being done on the inside when a tree has been attacked by the emerald ash borer.
Yes, at the beginning of that clip was a good shot of the larva, but the galleries where it's feeding beneath the bark and outside the wood, this is a specimen that has been well fed upon by the insect, where you have the feeding in a serpentine pattern, and once it gets moving, it becomes just a random chewing out of the cambium layer between the bark and the wood, and that is from the wood side, and on this one is the bark side of that gallery, and you have to take the bark off, or the bark has to fall off in order to see that, because you'll rarely, if ever, see the entry point of the young larva that the adult will lay an egg of as it then enters the tree. But then the exit hole is it's as large as the insect, and
kind of so a D shape. Is that right?
Yes, because they do have a flat back when they hold their closed wings. It's flat, and so they're not going to drill any more of a larger hole than they need, so it's going to be a D-shape exit hole.
Well, let me ask, true story, I'm sitting at home, I'm on the back porch, I see this bug, I've been looking at pictures of the emerald ash borer, and I see it. You said 95% chance that it could potentially be the EAB. What do I do? Who do I call? And do we know how much of that cost is on me as the homeowner? Is the city, will the county at all step up?
At this point, private trees are going to be responsible to the landowner that has that tree.
Because I know there, in Columbus, where I grew up, the city is taking care of the old neighborhood where I grew up. They took down the trees or treated the trees, and that was on the city's dollar. So it seems like there's a little bit of confusion in terms of you know, who's doing what or would be able to do what.
At this point, there haven't been any government programs that handle trees anything other than on the government land. So if you've got a street tree in your front yard, those tend to be owned by the town that you're in. So the city's treating the front yard street trees. But if it's in the back of your lot, it's your responsibility. And one of the things that's important with that is you got to do it. If you're going to treat your tree, you've got to do it early enough so that it can be effective. Once the tree is about 50% damaged, you no longer will be able to effectively treat it. So it's really important to consider that you should get after things early on.
Ash tree lumber is extremely popular. I mean, it's used in everything from furniture and baskets to the most popular baseball bat in the world, the Louisville Slugger. And, you know, failure on the part of residents at municipalities and cities to locate, treat, and cut down these trees does what for the future of these products and things that we enjoy, Noreen?
Well, I think we're seeing the end of most ash products because the wood won't be available. I think a very important thing to think about is with the loss of these trees, we need to plant new trees. So if you have five ash trees on your property and you've got room to plant five more trees, or even if you don't have any ash trees at all, planting trees is to benefit for all of us. It's very important going forward.
Well, a special thank you to my guests for breaking down the impact of the emerald ash borer on homeowners and our region as a whole. There are links on our website providing more information and resources so you can be proactive. Just go to wxxinews.org and be sure to click on the Need to Know link.